Senior year, it cost $6,000 to stay in the dorms. And when I figured that out, I was like, I might have to take a loan out for this. And my godbrother, he stayed down the street, real close to campus, walking distance, and he paid $300 a month. And so to live on campus, you had to move out in the summer, and move in, of course, so those are expenses. Then you have to get rid of stuff and then move it into storage. And I said, well, if I pay $300 a month where he stays, I could stay there for 12 months, a whole year. And it only cost me $3,600. So I saved $2,400 and stayed there. And it was, one of the best decisions that I made, which actually helped me graduate school debt-free. So that would be number four. And I would say number five is build the right relationships. When you get on campus, man, go and find out. You should know who has access to the money. And you want to go and you want to build relationships with that person. And you want to build a genuine relationship, but you also want them to know that you are serious and that you are there to figure out how to graduate from school debt-free. Get them on board. Let them assist you.
Now, when I'm looking at you, you're articulate. You're like Ivy League kid, okay?
Oh, thank you,
I
fam.
would never think that you had been in foster care.
I worked very hard at that.
So, tell us about your experience as a child in foster care.
Oh, my experience. Well, I went into foster care because my biological mom was a drug addict, and she had left myself and my older sister at our aunt's house, and our aunt, who was also on drugs, left my sister and I unattended.
And how
So
old were you?
I was 9 months.
9 months old?
Yeah.
Wow.
So we were left unattended. I believe I was crying, and my sister probably was too, hungry, things like that. And so CPS, was Child Protective Services, were called, and that began our journey into foster care. And so growing up in care was interesting. We actually moved around from home to home. Me and my sister were really, really inseparable. And then I believe I was about 3 years old, they had separated us.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And so I built that mother-like son bond with my sister. They separated us, and I went to this house with these people, and I cried. I refused to eat, and I was just there. And,
Wow, you
I
were
cried
3 years
myself to
old.
sleep, saying I want my sister. And then when I woke up, they tried to feed me. I wasn't having it. Just crying. I just want my sister. I want my sister crying. And then after about a day or so, they had to call my social worker and said, you got to come get this boy. He needs to be with his sister. And so,
How old was she?
well, seven.
Seven, okay.
But she was just literally the only person that I knew. Like,
Yeah.
so it was very interesting. You talk about me being articulate, but when I was a kid, I actually didn't talk to anybody except for her. So I just never, I just was very observant.
Wow.
So that happened. We got back together, and then she and I lived in a shelter in San Francisco, and we didn't know it, but the shelter was actually closing, and so people were coming and adopting the kids or taking the kids into foster care from the shelter. And we were the last two to go because we were a brother and sister couple. At the time, it was interesting because I only saw the numbers dwindling. Like, my friend was there today, gone tomorrow, and I was kind of like, well, what's happening? And so, you have that little feeling of, why doesn't anyone want me?
Yeah.
And, when it's just us two at the
And
end.
how old were y'all? You were 3 and 7?
Now, some time had passed by, so we were five at this point. I was five, she was nine. And so a lady named Mary Jackson came and sat with us for a while. I just remember her sitting because, again, I would only talk to my sister. So she talked to my sister for, it would seem like forever. Maybe it would have been 45 minutes or something like that. And the next thing I knew, we were on our way to Vallejo, California. She was taking us into foster care, and we moved out there. And that was September of me being 5 years old, and I started school.
Did you talk to anybody?
Oh man, a little bit, but my behavior was very
You acted up.
yeah,
Well,
that
of
was my
course you
thing.
acted out.
Yeah,
Look at
it
the circumstance.
was. Yeah, I mean, because some of those homes, even early on, I remember one of our foster dads, this dude saw a rat in the house and shot it with a shotgun. Like,
In
in front
front
of
of
us,
kids.
in front of us. Yeah, so you've seen a lot of wild stuff. I've been in like some different, places that kids shouldn't be, like, with prostitutes and crackheads and stuff like
Now,
that.
this is in your foster care home?
Yeah, because at first we got circulated through the family, and then you have just these different experiences. But foster care is itself is an experience that I wouldn't really wish upon anybody. I think that it's a character building experience, but a lot of people, you have to be built a certain way for that.
Yeah.
You know, and you have to have something to look forward to and be hopeful for. And for me, I found that in wanting to be free and wanting to live on my own rules and wanting to be happy. And I always said to myself, you know, if I'm ever fortunate enough to have a family, I'll never treat any of my kids, you know, less than, because as a foster kid, you get treated like a second class citizen. You know what I mean?
How?
You're like family, but you're not family, right? So at any point during, like, let's say holidays, or let's say a relative comes from, we're in New York right now, let's say a relative comes from North Carolina, right? And a lot of New Yorkers are from the Carolinas. They're going to be like, oh, okay, who are you? I say, I'm Kevin. And they're going to be like, okay, whose boy are you? Right? And then you're going to be like, and then somebody going to swoom in, might be even be one of your cousins, you know, your foster cousins or something like that. They're going to be like, oh, he's a foster kid. Or they might be like, that's such and such boy. Well, I ain't know her to have no other kids. You'd be like, oh, okay. And then somebody going to let you know that you're a foster kid, you know, or at Thanksgiving, you might not be able to eat what everybody else can eat.
They give you different food.
And you, foster care is no joke. At Christmas time, you're gonna get the lesser gifts. At birthdays, you know, you're going to get a smaller celebration. That happens. So you learn to understand the dynamic. But it's different because, you know, some people go into care as a teenager. When you understand this your whole life, you know, that you are living in someone else's family, it's a different type of psychology.
Now, does that play on your self-esteem?
I believe now, no.
But did it when you were again?
When I was younger?
Did it make you feel less than other people?
I would say to an extent. I've never been one to lack confidence, but at the same time, it's not cool.
Yeah, I can
it's
imagine.
Not cool. So yeah. It again, you know, it's the biggest part about it is a psychological battle.
And I want to give a little some information about the foster care system in America.
Mm-hmm.
So in America, a lot of teenagers who age out of the foster care system fall through the cracks. Some of them don't finish high school and therefore don't even think about college. Some end up addicted to drugs like Ritalin and end up addicted to street drugs. Some end up homeless or in jail. So it's amazing that you sit here with me today as a college graduate and an entrepreneur. And I just want you to know that I'm very proud of you.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, because, you know, we all have a journey, but it's like, how far do you have to go in that journey? You had to go a little bit further than most people.
Man, I don't know if it's a little bit. It's a lot of it because, and I'm not saying that to brag, it's because your responsibilities are different and you grow up faster. For example, you know, my friends, they're sitting there tripping off of, you know, what they got for Christmas. I'm just happy, you know what I mean, that I got something for Christmas. Or I'm just kind of like, well, at least, you know what I mean, at least you got something.
Mm-hmm.
Or when it comes to school, I'm literally at school, and everybody else is worried about, you know, each other's shoes and things like that. Man, I'm sitting there worried about if my social worker is coming to check me out of school today because I'm moving homes.
Wow.
And when you talk about moving homes, they like, yo, just go grab everything that you can grab right now, throw it into a trash bag. And we leaving.
About how many different families did you live with?
Total, I lived in 9 before I was 5.
Different homes before you were 5.
Yeah. And then by the time I finished, I would say maybe 13.
13 homes.
13 homes total. But that's light because, what is it? The average kid stays in at least 7.5, I believe. I'd have to relook at the statistics. But it's... You always had it on your mind that you might be moving and stuff like that. So you really got to stay sharp. So, you know, you got to say, okay, well, I need to have my grades on point and things like that going right in order for me to be able to, when I transfer somewhere else. And then you might say, you know what, I want a life as close to what normal is. But when you're a foster kid, you think everybody else's life is perfect because they're not in care. And so when you get older and out of care, you actually realize that there's no such thing as perfect. Right, but you weren't aware of that at first. So, it's just the psychology behind it is very deep, and so I believe that you have to do a lot of work afterwards on yourself in order to overcome those challenges.
And I was very disturbed to hear that. Like, I mean, what are you when you age out of foster care, you're 18.
Mm-hmm.
What do they do? Do they offer you? Do they get you a job? Do they get you an apartment?
Well, a lot of things have changed since I emancipated. One of the things that they have now, they have some things that are mandatory. And so actually in care now, a kid has the option to sign out at 18, but they also have the option to stay in until 21.
Okay.
In some places, 23, because they finally realized that, look, you basically throwing these kids to the wolves and they don't have anybody else.
I know.
So it's a different, it's an interesting experience.
Now, you speak to audiences about foster care, right?
Oh, absolutely. I speak to the professionals. I do professional development for them. And I also speak to my foster care brothers and sisters a lot. And, you know, the feedback that I give, that I get from them, you know, on the my presentations are phenomenal. And I stay in contact with them. And they always know that they can look me up on Facebook, hit me up on Instagram, and just talk to me. You know, just being real with them. Like, you know, this summer I had the opportunity to speak in Pittsburgh. I had the opportunity to speak in Ohio. I was the opening keynote speaker at the International Foster Care Conference in Sydney, Australia. So that was 925 people from 25 different countries. So that was an amazing experience. It's funny how foster care could take you anywhere, but when you're going through it, it's like, you know.
I can imagine.
And my older sister was with me until I was 10 in care, and then she got to go back home, and I had to stay. So that was like a huge defining moment.
You got to go home with your mom?
Yeah, she got to go home with my biological family because she had better behavior, and she had always wanted to go back.
But if you can take one kid, why couldn't they send you back?
Me and my sister acted completely different. I was very, very mischievous. I was into a lot of stuff, and my sister was like 4.0, tomboy, you know, kind of, she was tough, but she wasn't into stuff like me, and they just thought that it would be a psychological thing, you know, something that I couldn't really handle. Because, like, when I would have a home visit, then, you know, I would come back and I would act up. Like, if I, like, saw my mom or saw anybody that I was related to. And for me, I just kind of built up that attitude that, oh, if you don't want me, fine, you know. So that's pretty much, you know, that was a defining moment and one of the best things that ever happened, actually, because I'm glad I didn't go.
We're going to take a quick break. Please stay tuned.
You are a waste, a loser. Everyone hates you. Why don't you just stay in your car and keep driving? I'm serious. Drive until you run out of gas, then get out of your car and walk until you find someone who doesn't think you're dumber than bricks. Could take a while, but at least all that walking might burn a couple of calories.
You may not witness bullying like this every day. Your kids do. They want to help, but they don't know how. Visit stopbullying.gov to learn safe, simple ways your child can help stop bullying. Be more than a bystander at stopbullying.gov. A message from the Ad Council.
CNN.com recently named New York City as the most stressful city in the United States because of the high cost of living, long commutes, and overcrowded conditions. Some New Yorkers combat stress with exercise and fun activities in Central Park. But if stress has become too overwhelming for you to cope with, there is help. Harlem Hospital has an outpatient clinic that can help you deal with stress, alcoholism, anger management, and substance abuse. Seminars and workshops are held at Harlem Hospital on West 137th Street between Lenox and Fifth Avenues on the fourth floor. Workshops are held Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to noon. Call 212-939-3210 for more information.
Harlem has its own radio station, WHCR, 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem.
Welcome back to Paradigm Shift. I'm your host, Angela Harden. Our guest today is motivational speaker, lifestyle entrepreneur, author, and former foster kid, Kevin Y. Brown. He hosts the Create Your Life series on WHCR 90.3 FM on Sundays, 5:30 to 6:30 p.m. So, Kev. Okay,
yes,
so
ma'am.
Now let's get a little bit more positive.
Let's do it.
Yeah. Okay.
Let's go.
So did anybody in the foster care system mentor you? Like any of your foster families? Were any of them positive? Did they have a positive influence on you at all? That's a no.
No, it's not a no. It's not a no. I would say yes. I would look at one home, yes, but when it came to... So really what you, to me, what I'm always looking for at home is peace, right? And some homes were more peaceful than others. Now, in terms of the things that you need in order to go past your immediate environment, those things I found outside of the home. And so what I mean is that, for example, the home, when I went to Vallejo, I stayed there from 5 until 11 days before I turned 12. And so that home was, it was nurturing, but in order for me to become who I am today, a lot of other people who weren't related to me played a factor in that, or who were not in my foster home played a factor to that, such as my mentor, Mr. Fillmore Graham, who was the founder of the Continentals of Omega Boys and Girls Club. Shout out to the Q's for having their, Founders Day, November 17th. Then there's also, you know, Miss Carrie Wilson, who was my teacher in ninth grade, and who also basically took my hand and made sure that I went to college. But the Continentals of Omega Boys and Girls Club gave me a college tour. Sent me on a college tour. I actually had the opportunity to go 3 years in a row, which was amazing and a treat to get away from my foster home for about 8 days apiece. There was also, you know, Evelyn Polk, who is a mentor, God Mom Ease, what I call her, Pelton Stewart. So there were all these different factors and different people who helped me to become who I am now. Oftentimes the foster home was not positive, so what I would do is do the best that I could in order to stay out of the home by doing extracurricular activities, you know, getting involved in things that were positive, like student leadership, playing sports. Even 1 year I played football, knowing good and well I didn't like no football, but I just did that in order to stay out of the home. So after a while, I became aware of what circumstances I was living in, and I just wanted to be better, and I wanted to do better and have a better life. So therefore, I moved and motioned and took on responsibilities and made friends with people who I knew were going to be headed in the right direction.
Wow. And that's a better direction. That was quite a leap from a little boy acting up in school, right?
Yeah. Well, and one of the biggest things that helped me with that is I acted up until I got into a foster home where there was a man. So,
and that made a difference.
Oh man, it made a huge difference. Cause you know, I think one of the funniest things about being a boy is that when you see a man, you don't really want those problems. Even if you're bigger than him, it's just, you're kind of like, you know, you think about it. And so when he speaks, you know, you straighten up. And so I stayed there for about 5 years, definitely the most challenging 5 years of my life in terms of like physical and mental abuse. But I stayed there because I didn't want to keep moving around.
And how old were you?
From 11 days before I turned 12 until March of my junior year of high school, so until about 17. But one of the things that people don't know is when people go and they like, oh, I want foster kids, they're usually talking about the little kids. So when you become a teenager, nobody really wants you, so you can end up back in a group home. And we had already stayed in a group home. That shelter that I was talking about was a group home. So you don't want to go back to there because it's chaos in there. You're going to be fighting every day. People are going to be stealing your stuff. You know what I mean? So it's like, okay, well, if I just got to deal with a little bit of this, you know, being treated completely worse than everybody else, that's better than being in chaos and getting picked up in that county van, you know, after school. So, you know, you gotta pick your battles. But yeah.
Wow. And so he was kind of abusive though.
Yeah. So in my junior year, I actually ended up moving out of the house. He did something, and I called my county worker. And it's funny because I think also as a foster kid, you don't realize how much power you have because they were big and bad, you know. But when I made that phone call, I was just like, enough is enough. And I just went to the and called her, left a message. Their whole demeanor, my foster parents' whole demeanor switched up.
Uh-huh.
And they were like, why did you do that? And this, that, and the other. And I was like, nah.
So now look, I'm reading this book. It's called You Are the Placebo. It's by a Dr. Joe Dispenza. Mm-hmm. And he says that we have between 60 and 70,000 thoughts per day, mm-hmm. and that 70% of them are negative. How do you handle negative thoughts? Because do you still have memories, like bad memories from your upbringing in foster care?
I mean, yeah, but you learn to switch them from negative. I mean, you know, you're still going to have those things that may be triggers or may make you feel a certain type of way, but I think understanding that if you didn't have that experience, you wouldn't be who you are. So, for example, like I didn't get along with my biological mom for a long time, right? I'm the only kid that wasn't, well.
She didn't take back, right?
Yeah, but when I think about it, I'm happy for the way that I was raised. So, therefore, you can't be mad at somebody for not taking care of you and then you turn out all right, you know?
Right.
So, you have to, it's about the perspective that you put on things. So, yeah, did foster care suck? Absolutely. Would I wish that upon anybody? No. You know, do I feel for my brothers and sisters who are in the system, who are fighting that battle every single day and fighting those labels and statistics and things like that? Yes. And so what can I do to help? And that's why, you know, I do the work that I do and contribute.
So now you're very even-tempered. I mean, everybody has their moments, I'm sure. So I'm sure, like, you know, mm-hmm. you may have, like, a temper tantrum or something sometimes.
Yeah.
Maybe in the quiet of your own home.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But generally around here, you're very even-tempered. I mean, you even had a little situation with one of the, you know, the hosts here.
Oh, yeah, but she was being mean to me for no reason.
But you didn't blow up. It didn't get to be what it could have been. Do you know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
So what do you do to shift when something upsets you?
You have to analyze it. So, you know, I get upset with myself sometimes because I don't react probably the way that I should. I think the other thing is sometimes you have to realize where people are and who they are. And so if I'm my age and you're 50 or however old, just using this example with the person that you were talking about, and you're blowing up at me over something that's not really worth it, then I have to say, oh, if anybody gets upset about something, then you have to say, okay, is this worth it? And is this worth, how am I going to react to this? Is it worth me getting really upset? And then you have to say, you know what, this person is going to be doing this in 5 years. So I'll project in my head what it is that where I think you'll be in the next 5 to 10 years. And I'll be like, bro, who are you? You're not even talking to somebody who's even generally like on what you're on and on your level. So I'll just digress. For me, you can say whatever you want. As long as you don't touch me, we fine, you know. And that, you know, I'm chill, you know. And that comes from being in environments with lots of chaos and being in situations where you had to respond aggressively, whether it be verbal or physically and things like that. Then you learn to just be poised in other situations because nothing's going to happen.
But you're still different, though, because a lot of people who are in those situations, like mm-hmm. we got a lot of people in jail right now.
Yeah.
Because they can't handle their emotions.
Well, see, the other thing is I spent a lot of time on restriction in my room, looking at four walls. And I know I'm not built for jail. Could I survive? But I don't, probably, yeah. But I don't want to be there. You know what I mean? So,
absolutely.
Again.
So you think with your rational mind.
I'll digress. Like, you know, it all depends on the situation. And 9 times out of 10, the person who's acting like that, sometimes they're doing it because they can, because they think that nothing's going to happen, or, you know what I mean, because I'm chill, you know. And I'm like, that wouldn't have been worth my time. And for the very few times where I do, where I'm not holding myself to the highest standard or fall short of glory or discipline, I have an internal talk with myself. And I'm like, come on, man. You know, you're a public figure. You are a role model. You know, you can't respond like that. So it's constantly having that. But also one of the best things that I've done is I've learned to really, really keep people around me who respond in the same way that I do, where our conversations, I call them higher level conversations, are elevated, and who are about being positive. Like, I've seen enough negative to where, you know, I might be having a very bad day. You know, I might wake up aching or something like that from working out, whatever, but you know what? I'm still going to be positive because I've seen worse. So therefore, when people try to steal your joy, I'm just like, nah, man, you can't have it.
So look, tell us about some of the places you've traveled to. It sounds like you've been all over the world.
Oh, man. Traveling has been an escape and an eye-opening experience. I've had the opportunity to go to – I lived in London for study abroad in college. I've been to Paris. I've been to Rome. I've been to Egypt. I've been to Barcelona, Madrid, Jamaica, Mexico, Dominican Republic, Japan, Australia. I think that's it.
Wow.
Next on my list, I really want to go to West Africa. I want to go to Ghana to see the slave castle, Senegal to see the Statue of Liberty with the black man, his wife, and child. A lot of people don't know that that exists. It's this huge monument.
And it's where?
It's in Senegal.
Really?
It's amazing. I'll show you pictures of it. Like, it's amazing. I have to see it, and I have to bring home a miniature one of it. So when
and
I go,
it's
if
man,
you don't go before
it's,
me.
It's a I'll man, his wife, and his child?
Yeah, he's holding the child up, and the child is pointing to the future. It's so powerful.
Oh, wow.
So there, I want to go to Nigeria. I want to see the Gold Coast. And then after that, I want to go to Ethiopia and Kenya and then back down to South Africa. I love South Africa.
Well, tell me about South Africa. My daughters went there with my mother. So what is it that you love about South Africa?
Man, the people were just
really
amazing. The people, the music, and like, if you ever listen to my show, like, you'll notice I play a bunch of house music. Mm-hmm. That's because
like
of my
house.
Time in South Africa. I'm like, yo, like, there's nothing
so they
better.
They like house music.
They like house music, but they make some of their best mixes. And the people in house music, so my thing is, like, I like rap, you know, but rap tends to be very negative.
Yeah.
And I'm kind of like, man, I need more positive vibes in my life. So if you're listening to these songs with these, you know, these Afro beats and things like that, you're
yeah,
like,
I love
yeah.
He Has a Kayla.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So, you
the
know,
tones
it just,
are so uplifting.
Exactly. And it just changes your whole mood. So you're like super excited. I'm excited talking about it right now. But there's that, the people that I met there. You know, one of the best things that I think about traveling is when you go, if you're going by yourself, especially because I go to a lot of places by myself, I'll stay in a hostel. And, you know, people say bad things about hostels. Man, let me tell you, these hostels, especially like the ones in Japan, the one in South Africa, spick and span.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely, because you have reviews. So people going to review your hostel, so you better be clean, you know?
What's the difference in the cost of a,
what?
Like, percentage-wise?
Man, I was looking at South Africa. To stay in a hostel, basically like in a dormitory room where there's probably like four or five other people, is $13 a day.
$13?
$13 a night. Now, if you go and stay at a hotel, how much is that going to cost you? Maybe
right,
like 60,
right,
maybe
right,
30.
Right.
And it's like, okay, well, I'll spend 13 and then look at, spend my money elsewhere. But the other thing is that when you stay in a hostel, sometimes there's people who have been staying there for a couple weeks. Some people who might be attending one of the local colleges, they're staying there because it's cheaper. And what that does is it allows you to go in, find out what's really going on in the neighborhoods, in the city, and you can hit the ground running. Plus, they have tours and all these other things and services for you. And everybody's, like, chill. There's no pretentiousness. Whereas if you stay in a hotel, you know, you're pretty much you pretty much got to hope that the concierge is a super cool human or that you meet somebody in the lobby.
Right.
So, you know, I will say this, you know, I'm a single male traveling abroad. So if I had, you know, a lady, then, you know, we might do the hotel
might,
depending on how.
You might stay in the hostel.
Actually, I mean, but you can get a private room in a hostel as well, or you guys can stay in the same dormitory room. So I think it just depends, and it depends on the type of person that you're with. You know, like some ladies are down for the hostel. Some are like, boy, if you don't, you know, you better make sure that we at the Ritz. So, you know, it's a different, you know, it depends, you know. But
So how would you say
uh-huh.
that you created the life you wanted to live? What did you do? So from somebody who's sitting out there who's miserable, you heard my theme song. They don't like their job. They mm-hmm. don't like their life.
Mm-hmm.
What would you tell them?
You got to make a decision. I would say you got to make a decision. That's probably the biggest thing.
And once you make the decision, then what do you... Because you look, I hear all these... I listen to a whole lot of positive thinkers,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
And they all say, you know, you got to change your thoughts. That's true. But just changing your thoughts isn't enough, right?
Mm-mm. So one of my guests, Tony Laron, he said one of the best things that I thought. He said, positive thinking doesn't mean anything. He said, thinking critically and taking action does. He said, if I'm in a sinking boat, I can't think myself positively out of that sinking boat. He said, I have to think critically and then take action. So I would say you have to make a decision. And what that means is that you got to decide, you know what? I'm done with this. I'm tired. Like, enough is enough, and I'm going to make a change. And from there, I would say make a plan, and then you need to run that plan by somebody who you actually trust, who you know has your best interest, and who is a bit further along than you. And then you have
mentor.
To take action. Yeah, you need a mentor.
And do you try to find somebody who's in the field that you want to be in?
No, I mean, so right now I feel like we're more so talking about life. But somebody could be in the field that you want to be in. Somebody could be doing things that you aspire to be. You know, one of the biggest things is you know, it depends on what it is that you want. Like, every mentor is not going to be for everything. And then you can actually outgrow the mentorship of somebody. But that doesn't mean that you need to relinquish the relationship.
Right.
So that's huge, is that, you know, even though somebody might not be able to teach you more about, you know, about life because you've surpassed what it is that they have knowledge of, they still might be a great resource for you later on. And the other thing is that mentorship is a two-way street. And so that's huge. And actually, two Sundays ago, I did a show called 10 Ways to Make Mentorship Work for You. And that was one of the big aspects of it, is that mentorship is a two-way street. Is, you know, you're not always just taking. You have to give back to that person as well.
So you have to get a mentor and be a mentor, right?
To sometimes being, well, when I'm saying two-way street, sometimes it's, mm-hmm. you know, for example, if you're my mentor, then it might be me. You might be telling me about life, which you definitely have, and I appreciate that. But then you might need some things done around here, or you might need a favor from me. And so it's me being of service to you as well.
Give it back.
And then some mentors might be, you know, there might not be anything that you can really do for them, you know, that because they're pretty straight. And so they'll, you know, they're the call me when you need me, send me an email if you need me type of mentor. They're not there for, you know, really the one-on-one, let's go grab coffee, right? Mm-hmm. And so what they want to see is just that you win, because that makes them feel happy. Or they're like, you know what, go and mentor somebody else. And that helps me know that, you know, you're really taking what I'm saying into consideration, and that you're willing to pass it on, because it's all about legacy. Mm-hmm. And I think that's one of the things that's actually overlooked when it comes to mentors. People don't realize, like, if you mentor me or you gave me some type of game about life, then when I'm talking to a younger person or when I'm talking to a peer, I'm going to be like, yo, Ms. Harden taught me that. Angela taught me that, you know, or Ms. Wilson taught me that, who I just talked about. Mr. Graham taught me this. They taught me that. And so I'm talking about these people and what it is that they've done and how they've influenced my life. But it's not easy, you know, to change your life and to change the scope of it. And it's an everyday battle, and I'm creating my life, but I'm still every single day waking up, you know, trying to go and get it and make myself a better person. And it's not easy, you know, to break away from the social norms. Like, I'm a foster kid who played basketball in college, who was a clothing designer, who likes the salsa dance and is into house music, who's also a member of a Divine Nine fraternity, you know. So you have this interesting mix, you know. Plus, I'm from California on the East Coast, but went to college in Atlanta. So I'm like, plus I've traveled all these places, so I say words different. I'm aware of all of these different things. Like, my conversation could very easily switch to just talking about museums, from talking about, you know, Kobe Bryant, who's my favorite basketball player. So being that mix,
you don't like LeBron.
I mean, LeBron, cool, but Kobe Bryant is a killer. And, you know, his work ethic and his discipline. LeBron James is a great basketball player, but I'm a Kobe Bryant fan.
I'm a LeBron fan, so we just going to have to differ on that.
Yeah, that's cool.
That's different.
I respect them. But, so, you know, you have this mix. So what you have to do is you have to go and start doing things that it is that you like, right? And so you're going to end up moving away. Like, my idea of a great Friday night is not going to be at the club hanging out all the time. You know what I mean? Like, I might do it like every once in a while, but also I'm not the guy who's going to be popping bottles or who's, right, you know, Instagram, you know, or trying to do things for show. Like, that's not my steez. I'm more low key, and, you know, I do what I do. You know, like, if you know me, you know that I'm just a very real person. So being that person, sometimes you're going to be the odd man out. And when that's you're true. Making that choice to create your life and to do things differently, then you're just going to have to, you're going to have to ride with that. You have to ride with who you are. Otherwise, you're going to be unhappy. And so oftentimes when it comes to creating your life, it's really just a choice of whether you're going to be your authentic self.
Yep. Now, I got two more questions for you.
Yes, ma'am.
Before you go, because we got like 9 minutes left.
Whatever you need.
Okay. So I never knew my father. So when you talked about, you know, your life as a foster kid, I thought about my situation.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up with my grandparents, but I did have a relationship with my mother.
Mm-hmm.
So I listened to the show where you were answering questions from listeners, and they asked you to all kind of things. And you were really honest and upfront, and that was cool.
Okay.
But you talked about wanting to meet somebody who looked like you.
Mm-hmm.
So you went on this search for your father.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah. So I never knew who my dad was, and it's a long story, but essentially what happened was, is about April of my senior year of college, I was like, oh, you know what? I want to figure out who my biological father is. So I reached out to my biological mom, who said that I had a brother in San Francisco. So then I had to call, who lived in the same projects as my older sister's dad. So I had to call him to find my brother. He didn't find him. I had to call him for like 2 weeks. Then he found him. Then I called my brother, and he called his grandmother, who knew our grandmother, and we called and left a message. And then like 2 weeks later, she calls me back. She was on a trip to Arkansas visiting her daughter. And then she's like, I hear you. Calls me up. She's like, may I speak to Kevin? I'm going to say, hey, how are you? She's, I hear you may be Jimmy's son. And I'm like, maybe. And so she basically, she talks to me, very sweet, very kind lady. And basically then all of his siblings start calling me. And I found out that my dad had been dead since 93. And so then they asked me to send them some pictures. So I sent them pictures. And they were like, oh, yeah, you're definitely his son. And I'm like, who's not going to say that, you know, dude, I'm about to graduate from college. Who's not going to say that I'm somebody's son, right? In my head. You know, claim me. Because, again, in foster care, you know what I mean?
Nobody claims you.
Nobody claims you. But also, you just kind of, you begin to question what people's motives are and stuff like that. And so she sends me, the first thing I get of him is his obituary. And it's like printed on this like purple paper or something like that. And I'm like, I don't really look like dude. And he has a wide smile. Like if I smile, my smile does get wide. But I'm like, nah, that ain't enough. And so I'm like, nah, you know. And then everybody else is convinced. Their whole family is convinced. I'm like, yeah, whatever. And so they call me. I mean, they send me a ticket to Portland, Oregon, where my other two cousins are graduating college. Ironically, same year. Dual majors as well, so it's very interesting. I go, I stay with them, and it's an amazing experience, very nice, welcoming people, and then they're just kind of like, well, you look like Jimmy. And they like, you walk like him, your whole demeanor is like, and I'm like, yeah, okay, whatever. And then on my last day when I was about to leave, my aunt showed me, I was flipping through the picture book, and then that's like the best day of my life. I saw a picture of somebody that looked just like me.
Really?
And I was like, oh, this is awesome. Like I never admit that anybody looks like me. There's only one person that I'll admit, and I get this a lot, especially when I'm in the street. People say I look like Leon from the Five Heartbeat.
Yeah, I could see a little bit. So.
Yes, and yeah, I'm like, all right, I'll give you that.
I can see that, yeah.
Yeah, it's one of my frat brothers. He's notorious for playing me in front of strangers with that.
He's a little older.
Yeah, he's a little older, but he's from the Bronx on the low.
Oh, okay. Yeah, he's been to the station.
Okay.
Yeah, he's on the love zone a lot. Mm-hmm.
He's on the love zone a lot?
Yeah, I don't know about recently, but there were some times where he was coming through a lot.
I like to meet
the
him.
Love zone.
So that was like the best day of my life, man. I saw that picture, and that was everything. I've been waiting my whole life for that.
I bet. Wow. Well, Kevin, thank you so much for joining me at the Paradigm Shift.
With my other questions.
And thank you all for listening. I will leave you with a quote for the day. It is by Dan Millman. He is the author of The Way of the Peaceful Warrior. And the quote is, all of us are peaceful warriors, striving to live with a peaceful heart, but a warrior spirit, because it takes courage to live in this world. End quote. Kevin Y. Brown, you are living the life of a peaceful warrior.
Thank you.
Wake up one morning, you realize your life is one big compromise.
Compromise.
Stuck in the job you swore was only temporary.
Was only temporary.
I feel like the world is passing you by. Never done all the things you wanted to try. Stuck in one place, got a pain in your face from all your stressing out.
Stressing out.
Stressing out. You ask yourself, there's got to be more than what I'm living for.
What I'm living for. What I'm living for.
You ask yourself, there's got to be something else. Something more. Bye.
lot, but you can't let go of all the pain. Got so much to gain. Now is the time.
Wake up one morning. Jimi Hendrix won the Apollo Theater's Amateur Night in 1964 and returned to perform with the legendary Isley Brothers, Little Richard, and more on the iconic stage. On Saturday, November 26th, the world-famous Apollo Theater will pay tribute to the legend with Hendrix in Harlem, featuring performances by Fishbone, Ernie Isley, Nona Hendrix, Liv Warfield, Saul Williams, Gary Lucas, and more. Two shows only, Saturday, November 26th, Hendrix in Harlem. Tickets on sale now at Ticketmaster.com and the Apollo box office.
Harlem has its own radio station.
WHCR 90.3 FM.
The voice of Harlem.
Manna's Soul Food Restaurant is sponsoring free Thanksgiving dinners on Thanksgiving Day, this Thursday, November 24th, from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. at the National Action Network office, located at 106th West 145th Street in Harlem. This event is free and open to the public.
Hey, Bill DeFrosting here, news director for WHCR 90.3. Inviting you to listen to the up-to-the-minute news, weather.
We don't have to take our clothes off for that number one spot and lose my spot with you. Yeah, I've been about that life, now I want to hear something new. Tell me what you're drinking, whatever you're drinking, soon you're thirsty again. Let me tell you about my friend. He is patient till the end. If life was a song and you feel out of gear, then play this one for me. Whoa.
If I talk about Jesus, can I get some love on the radio? I know it's not easy, but Mr. DJ, please, I gotta let the world know. I just wanna help you love and get
put some walls in it.
Oh yeah, T.A. 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 Oh yeah,
T.A. Life is a song and you feel out of key.
To sing this one with me.
If I talk about Jesus, can I get some love on the radio? I know it's not easy, but Mr. DJ, please, I gotta let the world know. I just wanna help, help you love me, wanna make you smile, change the way you live, and talk about Jesus.
Hi, welcome to Thank God It's Monday with your host, Monique, on WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem. I hope you all had a beautiful weekend, and I hope you are ready to roll with me today. Today we are going to have a beautiful show. We are going to talk about the Monday Momentum, and also I just want you guys to be ready to have a beautiful Thanksgiving. You just hear Love on the Radio by the Walls Group, and coming up, today we're going to be very vibes. I really feel good. I really feel vibesy. So today we are going to be really vibes. And coming up next, it's going to be Yes.